All right. How things have changed since our last session. Things are moving rapidly in Victoria, which is fantastic. And obviously while we've got a big group on the call this evening, because I'm sure there's lots of questions around these guidelines and what do they mean for your event and what will your event look like in 2021 and what do you have to implement and the steps in order for you to make your event a reality next year, which are all things we're going to discuss this evening. We're going to look really closely at planning a COVID-safe event and give you some good practical insights into what some COVID-safe events that have already taken place have actually learnt through the process. And although they are in other states, they're certainly very similar guidelines. So we'll be able to give you some interesting insights tonight as well. Before we start, good to see some new faces on this evening. Just so you know, we have had two sessions prior to this. So if you haven't had the opportunity to see those sessions, they are recorded and Nicole will be able to point you in the direction of where you're able to access those. We looked at a session on reimagining your event. So that was really, I guess, inspirational content around how can you actually remodel, adapt and reimagine your event. And for those of you that have had the chance to see that or that participated live in that session, I think you'll find a lot of that stuff we talked about in that session is really relevant now to these guidelines and things that you need to actually do to ensure that your event is COVID safe. Our last session, which was a couple of weeks ago now, I believe, we looked at scenario planning. So that was at a time when things were still very uncertain for Victoria in terms of the direction for events and when things would happen. So this was looking at, you know, looking at scenarios, how do you actually define different scenarios for your event in order to determine the best way forward? So we looked really closely at how to do that and what that actually means for your event. So if you haven't had a chance to have a look at those, I encourage you to do so because they still support the future direction of any event in Victoria in terms of COVID and COVID safety. So for those of you that don't know, I'm Linda Tillman. I am the managing director of a regional tourism and events agency called Tilma Group. And we also run an events academy, which is Revents Academy, which is essentially similar to what we're doing right now. I do a lot of masterclasses, coaching, mentoring, strategic planning, development work for festivals and events across regional Australia. So my background is in regional tourism and marketing, and I've been working in the business and in this industry for close to 16 years now. So really passionate about how we create sustainable and viable events in regional destinations. So you can look us up online if you're interested to find out any more about that. Now, what are we going to look at this evening? So I guess my intention this evening is to break down the guidelines for you. So I'm not an expert in government guidelines or how they've actually developed these guidelines, but I'm very familiar, particularly with Queensland and New South Wales in terms of how to interpret the guidelines. So what I want to do with you this evening is actually break down those guidelines in a really easily digestible form. So I want you to be able to really think about and consider what your COVID safe event will look like and how you will implement these required guidelines. So we're now into a practical phase. We now know what's expected. So I want to try to make that, I guess, as pragmatic as possible for you this evening so that you can really start to consider and understand what your COVID safe event looks like. So as I work through the detail in the first part of this evening's session, I encourage you to really think about your event, think about the operational aspects, the marketing, all aspects of your event, and think about how you will actually implement or act upon these guidelines. So I want you to start thinking practically, take some notes, really think about, okay, well, how could we do that with our event? And at any time, if any curly ones pop into your mind or you want some clarity on particular points, what I encourage you to do is pop that into the chat box and we will come back and visit those points in our conversation section at the end. So what we do is we break up the session into two areas, for those of you that don't know, or two sessions, I guess. And the first one is really me delivering content to you. So this will be, I guess, the first 2 hours approximately will be me talking to you. And then what we do is we have some time after that, which we call conversations. So in the first session, as you can see on the slide now, these are the areas that I'll be covering with you. We'll look at what is a COVID-safe event. We're going to look at the steps to becoming COVID-safe in Victoria. So that's where I really want to break down those guidelines and what they actually mean. Without putting us all to sleep, because as you've probably seen, there is very comprehensive information available on the Victorian State Government website. So I'm not going down into the micro detail of that, or I will lose everybody's attention. But I do want to break it down, as I said, to make it easily digestible for you. Then we're going to look at your obligations as event organisers. So really starting to understand, okay, what are our obligations? What do we have to do? And as I do that, I also want to provide you with some practical advice from events that have already operated under COVID safe guidelines. So I've got two events in Queensland that I've had the opportunity to have detailed conversations with. And there's also an event in New South Wales that's coming up in January. So they're actually working on their COVID safe planning or implementing their COVID safe plan as we speak, getting ready for January. So I've been able to have good conversations with those events and get some good insights to share with you this evening, which will hopefully give you some more practical takeaways. I encourage everyone to jump into the chat box as well at any time. So even if you, it's not a question, if you want to comment on something or have a little conversation with everybody else that's on the call this evening, please jump into the chat box. It's good to see, you know, conversation happening behind the scenes. As you know, Nicole is on the line as well from council. So if you have any specific questions, Nicole will keep an eye on the chat box as well. And if she can, she'll respond to you as we go. Before we start, I'm just going to make sure that we don't have anybody else waiting to come in. No. And at any time, I know, you know, 2 to 3 hours is a long time to sit. So please feel free at any time, jump up if you need to go grab a drink, a bite to eat, or just need a bit of fresh air. Please feel free to do so because, as you know, these sessions are recorded, so you will have the opportunity to come back and watch it at any time. Now, just setting the scene, why has this been so hard? Why have we had to wait so long for these guidelines? It feels like, you know, when COVID hit in March, which seems like such a long time ago, you know, the events industry just was thrown into limbo. You know, it was a really interesting time. And I remember getting lots of phone calls from different events saying, oh my God, what does this mean? And, you know, it feels like, and I guess it really is reality, that the events industry has really been the one hit the hardest in terms of, you know, we've been one of the industries that was cut off right from the beginning and the one that's really going to come back last. And there's very good reason for that, because the one reason or the very reason everybody loves festivals and events is the very reason why we are a high risk. And we need to be super careful and extremely serious about health and safety, especially in 2021 or pre-vaccine. So as you know, public events have significant numbers of people and often in a confined space. They involve a broad range of activities. We're talking about, you know, the service of food and bev. We've got people drinking alcohol. We've got entertainment. We've got co-mingling of people and networking events. We've got mass participation of attendees. And that's why we love events, right? They're social outings. They're an opportunity for us to be just a number and to have fun. But that's the very reason why festivals and events are high risk, and why it's taken some time, particularly for Victoria, to be able to put forward some guidelines. But it's really exciting to see that the state government is trying as hard as they can to move things along as quickly as possible. So with this reason, events definitely need to be planned and managed appropriately in line with COVIDSafe principles to make sure that we reduce the risk of any virus. You guys know better than me, I'm based in southern Queensland, so I've been more fortunate than my Victorian friends. So you know better than, way better than me, what it's like to go through that extensive period of lockdown. And I know that nobody wants that to happen again. So that's why it's so important for us to look at how we can still deliver a really quality event and experience for our attendees in a COVID-safe way. That's our challenge. But we do not want COVID to spoil our events for another year. So I know it's hard, and I'm having a lot of conversations at the moment with different events around, oh, it just seems like a lot of extra work. There's, you know, investing in more resources. So it's a little bit overwhelming when you look at the guidelines and you look at the protocol and you look at the planning that you have to do to actually make sure you tick all of the boxes from a compliance perspective. But you guys are event organizers. You're resilient, you're hard workers. You know how to manage stuff like this. So it's just about getting it done. What you need to do is add another lens over your event. Another lens, she says. There's already so much to do with events. I totally appreciate that. But this is about adding a lens that allows you to look very closely at different areas of your event to ensure that it's COVID safe. But always coming back to the fact that you do not want to impact on the attendee experience. So the image on the screen is my local event in Toowoomba, Toowoomba Carnival of Flowers. So they went ahead this year, and that's one of the events that I'll be referring to because they did a very different reimagined version of that event in a COVID safe way. And some of their street art had some fun things like this on the sidewalks around the city of Toowoomba, which was really fun. And I think what it did is it injected this sense of positivity. You know, they did follow the guidelines. It was a very different version of the event, but they wanted to show that, you know, we can do it. So we can do it. And it's just important to actually consider the guidelines, follow the processes, and make sure that you're delivering a quality event for your attendees. So what we're looking at when we look at a COVID-safe event is an event that has been remodeled or adapted to satisfy COVID-safe guidelines. So you do have to reimagine your event. You have to think about the different elements of your event and how you can adapt them to be COVID safe. A COVID safe event is one that presents the lowest risk of spreading the virus. It's as simple as that. And as I break it down for you this evening, you'll see it's pretty common sense. You know, some of it you think, and one of the comments I had from one of the event organisers that's actually delivered a COVID-safe event in 2020 had given one piece of advice, which was, you know, just think about the basics. Almost take yourself back to, you know, preschool days and think about common sense stuff around health, hygiene and safety. So it's not tough, but there is quite a bit for you to consider. So, first things first, we need to get really clear on when you are permitted to hold your next event. So some of you may have seen this roadmap, or all of you have probably seen this roadmap. It's probably been your Bible for some time now. But what's happened now is that the Victorian state government has introduced a phased approach to returning to normality. And basically for events, that is based on attendee limits and density requirements. So it's all about numbers. And this is aligned with this Victorian roadmap for reopening. So what you'll see, and this is the interesting part, and you know, it's as you read the guidelines, you kind of, at some points, it kind of raises more questions than it does answers. But one thing I will say, based on my experience in Queensland, is that things change rapidly. So what we all also need to remember is that the government is responding as quickly as they can. And sometimes the information coming out may not be as clear as it could be. So don't be scared to ask questions. So when I looked at this roadmap to recovery and started to look at this phased approach, for me, I looked really closely at the COVIDSafe summer. So we're all familiar with the steps. So these are the steps that Victoria has been working through for some time now. But what is going to happen is once we hit December, it's going to break down into phases. So that's what they're calling COVIDSafe summer. My guess as to why they're doing that in terms of phases across summer is because that they want to be careful that we don't become too relaxed in the holiday season, and also knowing that that's also the peak summer festival season as well. So what they've done is put in place phases. So there'll be a gradual easing of restrictions, which will be on a 14-day basis. What I've worked out is if everything goes to plan, and that's what we also need to remember, is this is something, things can change just like that. We know that. So if everything goes to plan, this means that everything for the events industry could be back to normal, whatever normal means. It could be back to normal by March 2021. So the first few phases within that COVID-safe summer does allow for seated events. And then what it does, it essentially then progresses to standard and roaming events in the later stages. So from what I can read, freestanding events are not permitted until phase three, which is really around February, based on some of the dates and the 14-day basis. So freestanding events. So they're events where they're in open space, people are freestanding, no allocated seating or allocated space. So they will not be permitted until approximately February. Anything before that, before February, any events before February will require allocated and controlled seating. And that's no surprise because seated events are seen as far less complex to mass gatherings of big crowds. You imagine people, you know, at music festivals and that type of thing, where it's hard to, you know, reduce that social or to implement that social distancing. So that's a key thing, is freestanding events are not permitted. But if we actually look at some of the timing required to put forward your COVID safe plan or complete your checklist, it's probably not going to be until early next year until events are approved anyway. So it's important to know that, but I wouldn't get too concerned about that. So if you're not familiar with that, have a really good look at those phases. They're the key info. That what I've just shared with you is the key information. I think the key takeout is, you know, things could be back to semi-normal by March, all going to plan. And no freestanding events are permitted until phase three, which, all going to plan, will be around February. Anything before that must have controlled seating. They also obviously need to have their COVID safe plans or checklists in place, whether you're seated or freestanding pre or post February. So there's some key things there. You can see what they're trying to do is reduce the mingling or mass crowd, that kind of density of people in one space, more controlled environment by having people allocated to seating, and also trying to reduce the risk over that summer season where people are really in that holiday mode. Has anyone done the self-assessment to determine what tier they are in? If you have, I'd be really curious to know. And if you could just pop something into the chat box. So you would see on the Victorian State Government website, the very first step for any event in Victoria is to do this self-assessment. What they're wanting you to do is to determine what tier you're in, because essentially they have three tiers, and those three tiers determine your COVID-safe planning requirements. All events need to go through it. It doesn't matter what size or scale you are. You all need to do a self-assessment. And those lower tier events, so 500 people or less, the word is that that should be fairly straightforward and they should just breeze through. But the larger and more complex events will go up to a higher level and they may take a little bit more effort and time to be approved. And that's certainly what we saw in Queensland and still seeing in Queensland. The larger the numbers, you know, the higher the risk, the more risk factors associated with your event, then obviously the tighter controls and the more rigorous the process for you to go through. The other thing as well is that it's likely to take some time. So don't leave this until the last minute. And I'm hearing that from a lot of people that I've spoken to in the events industry. The process is likely to take some time, particularly in these early stages. There'll be high demand. Everybody will be doing their assessment. They'll be putting in COVID-safe plans. So just make sure you're allowing enough time. It certainly started very slow in Queensland and I still remember the frustration, but now it's much more quicker. And it's like there's a better relationship now between the events industry and the Department of Health. And I guess Department of Health have also had to adapt and learn. So that whole relationship has improved. Therefore, the process has become much more efficient and a lot quicker. So make sure you don't leave this process to the last minute. So if you haven't done the self-assessment, jump in tonight, tomorrow. It doesn't look like it takes too much time, but I certainly encourage you to jump in. Whoopsie, I've just got to let another person in. I encourage you to jump in and do that self-assessment as soon as you can, because that is going to determine your categories, which is going to determine the requirements and your obligations as an event organizer. So as you can see on the screen right now, all I've done there is just tried to give a really quick snapshot. So there's three tiers. We've got one, two, and three, and it's all based on risk factors, which you can see in the right-hand column, and also the anticipated attendee numbers. So everything from tier one, so that's your more highly complex events, over 5,000 attendees, and there's six or more risk factors. So they're looking at risk factors being, is the event primarily held indoors? So we know that there's a higher risk of spreading viruses when we're indoors. So the outdoor events are much more favorable. Does the event promote attendees to stand and roam around the venue? So like I said before, there's certainly preference around events that have allocated seating, so that controlled seating environment. Is alcohol served at the event? And that kind of was a bit of a why. A lot of events were asking, why is that a risk factor? Well, when people are consuming alcohol, they are a bit more relaxed and less inclined to follow social distancing, etc. And it also encourages co-mingling and people kind of getting together in small areas. So that's certainly a risk factor. Is there extensive singing, chanting, cheering, or exhaling during the event? This was really, really tough in Queensland. There were, in the earlier stages, there were a few festivals, music festivals that were held in a COVID-safe way, and you couldn't even stand up and dance. So we can dance in Queensland now, which was a very big milestone for us. But basically they're trying to prevent, you know, that contact and people getting a little bit too excited and relaxed. It kind of makes you think, how do you do an event when you can't do that? But you can. I've seen it work in Queensland. I've seen people dancing on chairs. It's very interesting. Number five, another risk factor is there close physical interaction between attendees and or participants? So looking at, you know, the size of your venue versus the number of people. So looking at, and also the period of time. Is the event held over multiple successive days with different attendees each day? So trying to reduce the number of attendees over multiple days. Will the event include participants or attendees from interstate? So if you are bringing in people from interstate, then your event is also seen as higher risk. So they're essentially the risk factors that will help determine what tier your event is. And as I said, the other factor will be around numbers. So 5,000 or more, 500 to 5,000, and 500 or less. So pretty straightforward. So as I said, jump in, do the self-assessment. And the first thing you need to do is to determine what tier your event is. If you already know what tier you are, fantastic, because we're going to talk about the requirements, the difference in the requirements for those tiers right now. Essentially, the difference is if you are a tier one or two, so you're a more complex event with higher attendee numbers, then you are required, and it's a legal responsibility, to ensure that you develop a COVID-safe plan for your event. So your key requirement is, as an event organizer, to not risk the spread of COVID. It's really as simple as that. And that's what this COVID safe planning is all about. So if you do fall into category of tier one or two, then you need to follow this process you can see on the screen. And once again, this is all on the Victorian State Government website. So this is not new. It's easily accessible for you. It gives you very clear staged process and assists you through developing a COVID safe plan for your event. So as a tier one and two, you have to create quite a comprehensive COVID safe plan, and you need to submit that to the Department of Health and then also the Chief Health Officer. So once the plan's approved, you then have to implement that word for word. If you change anything in that plan after it's been approved, you do have to resubmit. And the word from Queensland is, that is a nightmare. So think through the plan really carefully once, so you only have to do it once. And they're really strict. So they do come and do spot checks. So all of the events that have run in Queensland, Department of Health have had staff coming on site. You don't know, they're kind of mystery shopping. So they're coming on site and they're looking and they're checking against your plan. So they're really serious about the whole process. So make sure whatever you put into your plan that you are able to implement it. Really important. So as you can see, if you're a tier one or two, a more complex event, you've got to submit your plan. It goes through a review process, a review and an assessment process, and then essentially it goes into that implementation phase. So it's your responsibility as the event organizer to implement the plan as approved. So what could happen is you submit your plan to the Department of Health. When they come back to you with the approvals, there could be some other conditions in that. So they might say, yes, you have to do this, this, and this in addition to what you've already noted in your plan. And then that's your requirement. And as I said, it is a legal responsibility to actually act on that. So it's just about thinking through, and we're going to go through the different elements required within a plan in a moment. But it's just about thinking through how you deliver your event. And it's, you know, it seems quite overwhelming and a lot, but there's just little things you have to tweak or adapt in order to make it COVID safe. So there is, thankfully, thank you, state government, there is a COVIDSafe plan template available. So you don't have to create something from scratch. It has to be specific to your event and venue. So they're giving some guidance through this template, but you have to think through your own event. Essentially, what you're doing is you're setting out how any high risk activities within your event are going to be managed. So how are you going to reduce the risk of transmission of COVID between participants, attendees, contractors, staff, volunteers? So essentially, the plan will ask you, there's four key areas within it. Event details, event venue site details, including site maps. So they want to see the site plan and where things are located and the space that you have available versus how many people will be in that space. Anticipated attendance details and an explanation of COVIDSafe event controls. And we're going to dive into those deeper in a moment. So it's really looking at all aspects of your event. They also encourage you to attach supporting information. So you need to be able to illustrate aspects of your COVIDSafe plan. Remember, this is just tier one and two events. So anything over 500 attendees. So you need things like an operations plan, they want floor plans, they want cleaning schedules, any photos and maps or plans or anything that you can show to support your COVIDSafe plan will ensure that your approval gets through a lot quicker. And then as you've seen on the previous slide, essentially then it goes through an assessment process. So a panel of health experts are basically coming together to review COVIDSafe event plans for all events across Victoria. So it's a pretty extensive process. And when you think about it, you know, the Department of Health didn't ask for this either. And this was some conversations we've had in Victoria and New South Wales. There was a lot of frustration initially between the events industry and Department of Health because there was just a real lack of understanding of the events industry and how it works, you know, things like lead times. And that was one of the challenges in Queensland was events were waiting so long to get their approvals in place. And the thing was, Department of Health had no concept of the lead time required to run an event, and nor should they. I mean, that's not their specialty. So we just need to remember that this is not their core business. So communication is absolutely key, and getting started on this process as early as possible is really important. Now, if you're a tier three event, so they're events that are the 500 or less with less than four of those risk categories, then all you have to do is a checklist. So it's a much more straightforward process. It doesn't have to go through the assessment process, but you have to complete a checklist, and you have to have evidence that you've completed the checklist and that you are implementing everything that you say on that checklist. Don't forget, there will be people from the Department of Health that will do spot checks on events, even those smaller tier three events. So it's important that whatever you state in your checklist, so if you say, yes, you're doing that, you need to have an understanding of how you're actually going to do it in reality. So basically, it goes through the same things. So in the checklist, it covers off the same areas that we're going to go through in a moment as a COVIDSafe plan, but it's just a simpler process. It's not as rigorous as having to do the plan for a tier one or tier two event. And what it does is it just enables you as an event organizer to really consider the controls that you need to put in place to reduce the risk of any transmission. So it's a checklist to get you thinking. So once again, there is a copy of the COVIDSafe events checklist available on the state government's website. So they've made it as easy as possible for you. So jump on there and download a copy if you're a tier three event. And essentially it covers off on the key elements of COVID safety. So it wants to know your event details, which is pretty obvious. And then it dives into, you know, things around administration and oversight, record keeping requirements, including ticketing. It looks at spectator management, environmental and personal hygiene, and staff, vendors, and contractors. So it basically gives you a checklist under each of those categories of key things that you need to consider for your event. And as I said, it's important that you really seriously consider those elements and think about how you're going to implement those for your event so that you can actually have evidence if you have spot checking done on your event. So these are the areas. So when we talk about a checklist or a COVID safe plan, there's five areas that they cover off. And these areas are pretty much exactly the same as Queensland and New South Wales. They've just called them different things, which we like to do, don't we? We can't be the same. So these are the things that you need to look at really closely when planning your 2021 event. This is the practical stuff. These are the things you're going to cover off in your COVID safe plan, and these are the things you need to have activation plans around. Once again, there's so much detail on each of these areas on the state government's website, but I'm going to go through each one with you now. And I'm going to share some examples of how events in other states have actually implemented some of these guidelines. So this is where I want you, if you've got a pen and paper, really be thinking about your event. So thinking about, okay, how would that work for our event? And you also need to think about, do we have the resources to do it? Because that's another challenge that events are facing, is once they start looking at the requirements or the guidelines around COVID safety, they're starting to need to consider their resourcing and how they can actually do it. It's one thing to actually document in a plan and to come up with the ideas of how we want to do it, but you really need to think also about who will do it and do we have the resourcing at the moment to be able to do it well. So the five areas, exactly the same as I just mentioned with the COVID safe checklist. You've got oversight and administration, spectator management, cleaning and hygiene, staff, vendors, and contractors, and operational spaces. All right, let's start with oversight and administration. So, some things you need to ask yourself when you look at oversight and administration. It's all about how and who is going to do it. So, first of all, ask yourself, how will you ensure general governance arrangements are understood by all your team members? You need to know what team you have. And I know with a lot of our events, particularly volunteer run events, this is a real sticky point, isn't it? Because that's a challenge, having enough volunteers at the moment, let alone thinking about, okay, do we have key people to play a role around COVID safety? So what they want to know here is, do you actually have the team equipped to manage COVID safety? And that doesn't, look, it's not rocket science, absolutely not rocket science. What I've said to a lot of events is, even if you can just appoint a COVID safety coordinator. So it might be an existing position within your committee. If you've got somebody that looks after risk management, might be a good one just to add to their responsibilities for the next 12 months. But they just want to see that you've got, you know, COVID safe roles within your governance structure. You also need to ask yourself, how will you monitor the Victorian government's latest public health advice? And what we know is that that can change very quickly and without any warning. So do you have somebody that can actually keep up to date with any public health advice and make sure that they're incorporating that into any planning or communication? The other thing in oversight and administration is, how will you ensure that attendees are provided with these key public health messages? Things like, you know, we've all heard this many times, the whole message around, you know, the advice to stay at home if you're unwell. So you need to think about your communication strategy. What they want to see is that you have clear process in place to be able to communicate to attendees these key public health messages. So communication is really important, and not just to attendees, but also to staff, to volunteers, to contractors, suppliers, anyone coming on site, stall holders. So there needs to be a really good communication strategy in place. Another big one is, how will you enable clear and detailed record keeping? So this is all about contact tracing. We are all so familiar with this now. You know, how many times in the last week have you had to scan a QR code and log in to have a coffee somewhere? So it's not easy when you think about that with free outdoor events. So if you're a free outdoor event in a public space, it's really challenging, you know, to understand or even comprehend how you can actually capture everybody's details. But you need to think that through, and I'm going to share some ideas with you shortly. And then you need to, when we look at oversight and administration, you also need to assess and note how you will mitigate any flow-on implications to other local communities around you. So that all comes down to communication as well. So what are you doing to actually, or what will you do to communicate in the instance that there is, you know, a case of COVID as a result of your event? You need to be really thinking about how that communication will roll out and support surrounding communities as well. It's a bit like risk management, you know, having in place, you know, what's your media and communication strategy if something does happen with COVID at your event. So a couple I just wanted to share with you. Firstly, on the left, Sydney Festival. So Sydney Festival is coming up in January 2021. They have been very focused on communication. Their approach has been regular, transparent, consistent, updated communications to their audience. So that's through newsletters, through social media, and having dedicated area on their website where they're encouraging people to remain up to date. One of the challenges that they're having right now is that things are changing often. And you'll probably find this in Victoria as well, is, you know, things are just constantly changing and evolving for better, which is great. But it's really important to ensure that the audience is up to date and super clear on what to expect at the event. And that's a really important one that Sydney Festival is focused on, is because this is a really remodeled version of Sydney Festival, it's important for them to actually really make it clear to attendees what to expect. And because the goalposts are changing so regularly, they need to make sure that they're constantly updating attendees around what their requirements will be at the event. The last thing they want is, you know, thousands of people turning up and getting frustrated with a particular process that's a COVID safety requirement. So making sure that your attendees are informed in advance through these communication channels. Another event is the Rotary Ride the Range. So this is a cycling event, and that was held this year. For them, it was about this, you know, constantly updated COVID page on their website. And you'll see this, a lot of festivals and events now have this, events that are planning for 2021, is they have a dedicated section on their website around COVID-19, which has got all of the information, what to expect, what the requirements are for participants or attendees, and then supporting that content on the website with regular communications, once again, via things like social media, electronic newsletters, notifications, so push notifications and things as people are arriving at your event. So thinking about all of those different channels where you can be communicating, not just to your attendees, but also to your team, to your suppliers and stakeholders. So if you've got databases of all of these contacts, that's great. But as we know, there's a much broader attendee audience that needs to be communicated to as well. And people that have perhaps never come to your event before either. So making it really clear on expectations is important. Now, another key bit I wanted to just share with you when we talk about oversight and administration, so around record keeping. So contact tracing is really important. We're seeing now some software that's coming out to support this for different events, and some of it's even free, which is great. One of the things that's been learnt, I guess, from events that have had COVID-safe events already is that having people undertake this process before they arrive at the event is going to save you a lot of headache and also attendees a lot of frustration. And I did notice as well on the Victorian State Government website that they are strongly encouraging ticketed events. And the reason for that is because it supports contact tracing. So even if your event is free, you can still be ticketed. It's just a free ticket. But what that means is you're capturing a large percentage of people before they actually come to your event. And then you can supplement that with the QR codes and, you know, sign-in sheets, etc. So you really need to think about how you are capturing people's details as part of this contact tracing. So this whole idea of, you know, paid ticketing or ticketing in advance if it's not a paid event is really important. So what I've got on the screen right now, Intix, I haven't actually had any feedback from anybody that's used this, but it's Australian-based. All of the research that I've done, it looks great. So this is a ticketing platform, but what they've actually done is they've actually integrated an app into the ticketing platform, which allows organisers to actually capture the necessary information and to also provide that, they're also capturing that information so it can easily be provided to government if it needs to be. And it's all in compliance, obviously, with privacy laws, but it's just making it easier for organisers. So getting pre-ticketing done, contact tracing, all in one go is highly recommended. For those events where, you know, it is unticketed in an open public space, or you've got spectators, say, at a cycling or a triathlon event, you really need to think about how you can capture those people. So QR code registration systems, you know, big signs displayed around different areas encouraging people to register via QR codes is really useful. The Ride the Range event that was held in Queensland, so talking to them, what they did, so they had, I mean, the cyclists or any participants, so if it's a triathlon, a cycling or a trail running event or anything like that, obviously the participant component is quite easy because they have to register. So that covers any participants. What they then did, the cycling event, is they had a volunteer register or a team register. So any staff, volunteers, all had to have sign-in, sign-out details. Then they had all food vendors had to provide their names and contacts on arrival. So they recommended everybody come 30 minutes earlier and they had to go through that process. Majority of them had their details upon booking, but they had to make sure that they had the relevant details for COVID contact tracing. Then the challenge for them, so this cycling event, was the spectators. So they had volunteers that basically walked around with pin boards capturing people's details. They did also have QR codes positioned around different areas, but it's really hard to know where you're going to have spectators. You just need to focus on those areas where there's large numbers of people. One of the things is, I'm not sure if this is happening in Victoria at the moment, but there is a bit of frustration around this whole contact tracing process. So having to go places and constantly sign in, sign out. We know that we have to do it, but people are getting frustrated by it. So if we can make it as easy as possible by integrating it into another process, so saying, you know, rather than you have to sign in or sign out, it's, you know, all events now have to be ticketed, whether it's a free ticket or not. And that allows us to also capture contact tracing information. That just means it's a much more efficient process and your attendees won't be so frustrated by that. But look into the software. So Intix and also Eventbrite. So a lot of people are familiar with Eventbrite. They've actually launched a whole range of different tools and resources to support events in contact tracing and collection of details. So make sure that you have a look at that as well. It's another good option. The other thing is when we talk about communication is there are loads of resources, tools, resources on the Victorian State Government website. So don't feel like you have to create these yourself. So if you're looking at, you know, if you're looking for signage, you're looking for logos, you know, you're looking for digital tiles to go on your website or to your social media channels, there are heaps and heaps of tools and resources that you can download. So these, you know, keep your hands clean. They could be things that you laminate and put in some of your toilets at the event. You know, keeping the 1.5 meters apart. What I've seen at some events is they do them as big kind of poster size, put them on easels and have them positioned around different areas. We cannot force people to do this, but it's our obligation as event organizers to communicate to them the expectations of what they should do. So that's our first one, oversight and administration. So it's all about how you're going to do it, how you're going to communicate, who's going to do it. The next one is around spectator management. This is all around the good old physical distancing. The elbow tap. So how will you, as an event organizer, make sure that physical distancing requirements are maintained at your event? So think about your event. Picture your event right now, the last event that you had. Picture where you have crowds of people. Where do people congregate? Where are people co-mingling? Is there a bar? How will you ensure physical distancing in those areas and at the whole event? You need to also think about what are you going to do to screen for COVID symptoms. So for staff, for volunteers and attendees, what are you going to do to screen them? And there's a lot of options now around self-screening. So that is an option as well, is putting that responsibility back onto the attendee. How are you going to monitor the number of people at the event at any given time? So if you've said in your COVIDSafe plan that you are under 500 people, how do you actually monitor that? If it's a seated ticketed event, that's obviously quite straightforward. But if it isn't a seated ticketed event with allocation, then how will you actually monitor your numbers? You need to be able to explain that. You also need to be able to explain how you will incorporate the management of any suspected COVID cases in your first aid plan. So if you are an event that has a really comprehensive first aid plan, you need to, and you're even in a risk management plan, most of us would have a risk management plan, you need to talk about how you will manage a suspected case. So what would you do if you had somebody at your event with very distinctive COVID symptoms? How would you deal with that? An interesting point that came up around this is that any tickets that you sell to your event should be refunded if a ticket holder is unwell. So if somebody screens themselves and says, I have COVID symptoms a week before your event, you are obligated to give them a refund. That's something for every event to just remember, because we often have our own terms and conditions around ticketing for our events. And usually, you know, a month before the event, no refund, etc. So there's certain terms and conditions you have in place. But if it's a suspected COVID case, then you are expected to give a full refund to that ticket holder. So that can have financial implications. So it's important to be aware of that. And obviously, everyone's also aware that insurance is a bit of a challenge for events in terms of COVID cancellation as well. So another financial consideration to be mindful of. I love this. So how do we actually keep people apart at events? Well, let's make it fun. And that's what some events have been doing. The Gold Coast Caravan and Camping Expo. So that was one of the very first events we had in Queensland as a COVID-safe event. They had staff dedicated to social distancing. So they had them in these vests, you know, and their job was to keep people apart. And obviously they weren't walking around and physically keeping people apart, but basically just preventing that clumping of people and just really keeping an eye on areas where people are congregating and just making sure they're reminding people that, you know, they need to spread out. Another really cool one, someone only told me this yesterday, I haven't actually seen it myself, but at Movie World on the Gold Coast, they actually have their COVID ambassadors dressed up as superheroes. So just making it fun. These people are there just to remind the attendees of the importance of social distancing. Once again, we're dealing with humans. It's really hard to, you know, force people to do this. But once again, all we can do is be responsible as event organisers and put in place these types of things to try to prevent any risk around COVID at our event. So looking at social distancing ambassadors could be something for any event to do, you know, just having vests on. You could dress people up as characters, have a bit of fun with it, and just remind people the importance of social distancing. Now, managing crowd density. So when we talk about, you know, physical distancing, managing crowds, Sydney Festival has spent a lot of time. So if you imagine a festival in a big outdoor space, it's actually spread across multiple venues, but then they've got a big outdoor space. You know, it was really important for them to look at how they manage crowds, how they can actually physically keep that 1.5 meters between people, and also to keep the distance when they're doing queuing. So there's a number of strategies that they've put in place. So if you're an outdoor event, you may take note of some of these. So in order to keep that 1.5 meter distance in queues, because that's another challenge with events, we often have people queuing up. So they're queuing up to get in the gate, they're queuing up to get some food, they're queuing up to go to the toilet. If you think about your event, there's often times where there's bottlenecks and people are in a queue. And we're usually trying to get them through as fast as we can, right? Well, one thing that you now need to consider is how do you keep 1.5 metre distance between people in queues? And you may have seen, I've got a photo to show you on the next slide, but there's, you know, a lot of places are now putting stickers on the ground or marks on the ground. You don't have to go and buy stickers, but it might be, you know, spray painting if it's on grass, spray painting crosses on the ground, just visual prompts for people so that they're like, I know myself when I see them, I go, oh, okay, she's there. I have to stand here. So it's really important to look at those things. And that's something Sydney Festival is doing to kind of look at that distance queuing, is looking at the marks on the floor and also using bollards. Now, this is pretty cool. You may have seen a few examples of how music festivals are looking at, you know, having those pods, different pod type seating. I've seen this a bit in Queensland lately as well with outdoor events, is they're actually, we're talking about grass areas in front of a stage. So we don't have seating, but what the Sydney Festival is doing is managing outdoor seating by using pods. So they're calling them pods. So it's on the, where this lady is sitting here, there's a demonstration on the ground. So it's a 2 metre by 1 metre area that's going to be marked out on the ground. So all individuals, so there's only one person allowed in those pods. And they're obviously going to have the distance between them. Some other events have actually been doing it based on family or friend units. So you can get a, you know, 3 by 4 metre, for example, pod for your family to be in that same pod. What they decided to do at Sydney Festival, they did look at that, but they found that it was going to create too many challenges. So if there were changes to groups, different people coming or, you know, a change of name, or they just thought that it was going to present them with too many challenges in the planning stages. So they thought for them, it's easier just to mark it out. Obviously, you can sit next to your partner or family member, but they've gone down the track of doing these 2 metre by 1 metre pods, which I've seen once again happen at a few events in Queensland. The other thing that they've done, this other image on the screen, this colourful image, this is actually their site plan. So what they've done to try to create, to try to reduce the density of crowds, is they've colour-coded their site and they have corresponding wristbands. So what they're doing is they're reducing the number, the total number of people in any one area at any time. So if I buy a ticket to the Sydney Festival and my wristband is pink, I am only allowed in that pink area. That's my event. So once again, for your event, you need to think about that, right? Because you go, okay, if I've got attendees that are only in those particular areas, what's the entertainment like? How do you manage that? Do you need more entertainment? How do you sell that? You know, is it, do you buy a ticket into the pink area, knowing that that's the experience in the pink area? So it's really important to think about the experience that visitors will have when they're in that particular space. The other thing that Sydney Festival is doing to reduce or to manage spectator numbers, crowds and mingling, they're actually not having any intervals between shows. So they're reducing the duration of their shows, no intervals, in the hope that that will reduce any chance of crowds congregating together. So it'll basically be a in and out type arrangement. You come in for the show, then you're out. So there's no, let's stop for an hour interval. Everyone has a few drinks, sits around, co-mingles. That's been removed to try to reduce any risk as well. The other thing they've had to look at is really look closely at the entrance and exit. And you may have seen this starting to unfold in Victoria when you get out and about. Most places now have a designated entrance and a different designated exit. The same for events. You need to think about your entry point and your exit point, so you're not having large number of people trying to come and go. You want to try to think about that flow. really thinking about the flow of people on your site so that you're not creating any bottlenecks. So looking at your site, remember what I said at the start, you will be required to put a site plan together if you're a tier one or tier two event. So keep in mind some of those things you need to be thinking about within your site. How do you actually prevent that commingling and prevent people from congregating in particular spaces? So these were what I was just talking about, you know, signage and the stickers on the ground. So these are prompts for people just to support you in putting out that message around the 1.5 meter distancing. If I give an example, I mean, the Ride the Range, which was a mass participation event, so a large number of cyclists. So for them to actually manage spectators at that event, obviously, the cyclists was a little bit easier. They could manage those a bit easier. They were just given specific start times. So there were different groups of riders with different distance races. So they used a large car park to corral all their cyclists. This wasn't, I guess, unlike a typical cycling event, but they just gave people designated spaces. So 100 people at the most in one designated space, making sure that they could enforce the 1.5 meter distancing. They also used COVIDSafe ambassadors, so those lovely people that encourage social distancing. And they used a lot of signage as well. So just prompts and reminders for everyone to go, okay, yep, 1.5 meters, just really reinforcing and reminding people the importance of that. And one of the things that the organizer of Ride the Range said is they found that people have become more mindful of social distancing and they were really well behaved. So spectators, participants, everyone was just so grateful to be out and about and at an event. They're very well behaved. They're like, okay, yeah, 1.5. Everyone's just naturally starting to do that now, which is going to make it easier on event organisers. This is a handy document. So when we talk about the screening of staff, volunteers, food vendors, contractors, anyone that's coming on site, that's really important. So the Victorian government has got resources available to help you with this. So this is a health questionnaire that's available on the state government's website. So as I said before, they've got oodles of resources available. So don't feel like you have to create anything yourself. But this is an opportunity for you to use this questionnaire to help screen any staff or volunteers. And that's just something you need to keep on record. All right, cleaning and hygiene. Can you believe we're having to talk about cleaning and hygiene? Well, when we talk about events, large numbers of people, I mean, we've all been to those events where we dread going to the bathroom because, you know, it's always an interesting experience. It's really important for us to have very robust, thorough cleaning and hygiene processes. So as part of your COVID safe planning and even your COVID safe checklist, you need to actually talk about how you are implementing good cleaning and hygiene practices in your event. So some things you need to think about with cleaning and hygiene is how will you ensure that you have adequate provisions for hand washing and hand sanitization? So where will you put it? How much will you have? How often will you top it up? Who's actually going to do that? You need to think about how you ensure that there's enough facilities available throughout the event. You know, we can't have people queuing for long times to go to bathrooms and toilets, so they want to make sure that there's ample facilities readily available. How will you make sure that frequently touched objects are cleaned regularly? Just to give you an idea of what they're thinking there and thinking a little bit beyond just our own personal hygiene, the Ride the Range event that was held. So they put the bikes, the bikes actually get loaded into a truck and back out to go to a separate point. What they actually had to do, and this had to be part of their COVID safe planning, and they had to have photo evidence of this. So it was all the bikes. So the bikes would come, the bikes were racked. There was only one person that could take the bike and pass it to the person in the truck. So the person that picked the bike up on the ground had to wipe down all the handlebars and contact, main contact areas, hand it up to the person in the truck. They then had to wipe it down once it was racked in the truck. Same had to happen at the other end. Because you've got bike riders, I mean, a lot of sweat, fluids, whatever else. So it was really important for that event, and that was something that was enforced by Department of Health, is that they had that process in place to make sure that there was good hygiene around the handling of the bicycles. You also need to think about how you make sure that any bathrooms, shared spaces are cleaned regularly. We know that that's a challenge with events. We don't have enough people as it is. So you need to think about how you're going to have enough resources, who's going to do that, and how often will they do that. Needs to be noted in your COVID safe plan. The best tip I got, or the best piece of advice from Ride the Range, was keep it fun. So they cleaned the permanent, they had permanent toilets. They cleaned them every hour. And they also had port-a-loos that they cleaned after every two uses. So they had to have people designated. So they had to get more volunteers that were just designated to cleaning. So they made it fun. They named them Susie Lou, Bella Bog, and Joe Crap. And they were names on the actual volunteer list. So they made it fun, and these guys got into it. They knew they just had to do it. It was part of the job. It was really important to their COVID safe plan. So they just made a bit of fun out of it. So they actually had to provide a cleaning plan to the Department of Health, and that allowed them to be more mindful. It kind of prompted them to think about that whole thing of the bikes, you know, loading the bikes on and off. So that's a lot of contact. That's a high risk touch point. So they had to make sure that they covered that in their cleaning plan to go to the Department of Health. So thinking about all of those different times and areas where there's high contact of things that need cleaning and sanitization. Now, another one is staff, vendors, and contractors. This is the other area you need to think about when you think about your COVID safe plan. So it's not just about you. You have a lot of other people that come on site at your event, don't you? In addition to volunteers, and if you've got any paid staff, we often have, you know, food vendors and stall holders and, you know, subcontractors, like people that come on to do electrical work, or even council staff coming on to inspect health and safety. So you need to think about all those people that are coming on site. You need to think about how you will ensure that all of your staff and volunteers have access to appropriate PPE, so personal protective equipment. And they also need to have training in how it's used. And there is free training online that you can access. It's really basic stuff. You need to think also about how you'll monitor the well-being of your staff during the event. Also how there's going to be physical distancing maintained between staff and attendees. So if you've got volunteers doing, let's just imagine you've got volunteers doing surveys. So it's a typical thing, you know, you walk around at an event as a volunteer, sitting down and chatting to someone and doing surveys. They're the things you need to think through. Where are there opportunities for volunteers to be close to attendees, and how do you make sure there's 1.5 distancing? You know what? Most of the time, it's just about making sure the volunteers are mindful. This is not rocket science. A lot of this stuff is just, it's just getting us thinking. And food vendors is a big thing. So when we talk about, you know, staff, vendors, and contractors, any food and beverage service must align with the Victorian government's COVID hospitality sector guidelines. So it's also important as an organiser that you're making sure you've got copies of other COVID-safe planning requirements from any third-party contractors or vendors. So when you have that, or when you undertake that process of recruiting for food vendors or stall holders, part of the process now needs to be that you ensure you get a copy of any of their COVID-safe plans, and to make sure that they're also adhering to any regulation around food bev. You also want to encourage food vendors to reduce any touch points during service. So, you know, encouraging things like, and this is something you can do as well if you've got merchandise stalls or even ticketing at the gate. You want to make sure that you've got things like contactless payment methods and ensure that things are always in well-ventilated areas. One thing that's recommended, which I really don't like for food vendors, is where possible, they want food and beverage to be sold in packaging to avoid double handling. I understand why from a COVID perspective, but the impact on the environment is horrendous. You know, I feel like we've spent years trying to encourage events to move away from packaging and to be more environmentally friendly. And I feel like this is a step backwards, but look, we have to do what we have to do. That's my little rant, sorry. any takeaway food and drinks must be consumed in allocated seats or picnic areas. So you can't have, you know, food court style seating. You need to make sure that, once again, you're trying to prevent that congregation of people. And if you have alcohol at your event, you may need to reconsider. And once again, I know that's often a revenue stream for some events, but you really need to reconsider that because it could impact on the success of your COVID safe plan. They're not saying you can't have it, but you need to be able to show really, really well how you're going to manage COVID safety when you have people that are consuming alcohol. And the final point that you need to consider in your COVID safe planning is operational spaces. And we touched on this a little bit with the Sydney Festival, and I've given you some really good insights into how they're managing, you know, not just spectator management, but also their site plans and layouts, and how they're managing queues and high traffic areas. So you need to think about all of those different spaces where people can congregate in a small area. So things like public transport hubs, you know, where people are waiting for buses or taxis. It could be, you know, queuing up at the entrance or the ticket office. It could be the toilets, you know, people buying merchandise. It could be, you know, in front of the stage. You've got to think about all of those different operational spaces where people would typically congregate. And in your plan, you need to actually clearly show what measures you will put in place around physical distancing and managing that density of the crowd. So this is where site planning and really rethinking your site. So this is where a bit of creativity is required to sit down with your site, start mapping it out and playing around and thinking it through to actually get an understanding and appreciation of how you could lay your site out so that it's as COVID safe as possible. These are the things that Department of Health are going to look really closely at. Now, some of you may recall this video from, I think it was the first masterclass we did when we talked about reimagining your event. But I wanted to show this again because it's just really good to demonstrate. And obviously, this is an event, this is a large scale event. It's a music festival in Western Australia, Good Day Sunshine. And it was capped at 5,000 people. But what they had to do was manage that 5,000 people. So they split it into four separate areas. They made it a bit fun by naming each area after a famous surf spot in that region. And then they had a revolving stage in the middle. So basically each of those quadrants only had 1,250 people. So that's going to seriously decrease the risk of any spread of COVID. So this is kind of thinking you need to put in place for your event. And I'm not by any means suggesting something as extensive as this, but even just thinking about the Sydney Festival where they had the site color-coded with corresponding wristbands. So it's a similar concept and it's a good model for larger events. But it just gives you a bit of, I guess, context around how do we manage crowds, which we haven't really had to think about a lot in the past. I'll just share this quick video with you. So as you can see, just thinking once again about how do we reduce the number of people in one location. Another thing we need to think about, so there's another event in Queensland called Mitchell Creek Rock and Blues Festival that was held a couple of months ago now, a music festival with on-site camping in land from Gympie in Queensland. So camping is another thing you need to think about. So campgrounds, you know, high traffic areas at festivals. So a lot of, you know, music festivals or even, you know, caravan and camping festivals will have campgrounds. And people like to congregate in those campgrounds after the day or, you know, when they're finished with the entertainment. So there's potential of that congregational co-mingling. So it's important to also think about places like campgrounds. So what they did at the Mitchell Creek Festival in Queensland is they had a warden. So a campsite warden was on board and in charge to manage the campgrounds. And what they had to do was spread it out. So space is your best friend if you're an outdoor festival. If you can access more space, take it. What they had to do was spread out as much as they possibly could. And then they had restrictions around their camp spaces. So you can see here, they had some clear guidelines on camping. And then they had a warden that actually roved around and made sure that people were adhering to that. So a maximum of 20 people per camp. It was, they had to display a list of names for their area. So they had a set allocation, which is typical, but a 6 meter distance from the neighboring campsite was also important. They have to strictly stay out of other people's camp and follow the warden's instructions at all times. So camping is another area. So when we talk about, you know, high traffic areas, it's not just toilets or, you know, train stations or merchandise queues, camping. So think about your own event. Every event is different. What are the areas where you have high traffic? And they're all the points. So they're what I've just spoken to you about, essentially the core areas that you're required to consider for your event in a COVID-safe plan. So whether you are a tier 3 doing a COVID-safe checklist, or you're a tier one or two and you're required to do a more robust COVIDSafe plan, they are the five areas that you need to consider for your event. I know it's a lot. When we look at it like that, you think, wow, that's a lot for me to consider. But there's many areas within that where it might just be a little tweak to what you're already doing or a small thing that needs to be added to actually meet that requirement. Now, I just wanted to share with you some other words of advice from those COVIDSafe events that I have spoken to. We need to make sure that we're focused on ensuring that the attendee experience is just as good despite the COVID safety measures. It's really important that despite all of this, as an organizer, you remain completely focused on the attendee experience. So make sure that when you're considering these guidelines and requirements, you're always thinking about how will that impact the experience for our attendees. What the Sydney Festival did and suggest is that you do some role playing of these different processes to actually see how they will work in real life. Because sometimes you note things in paper or on paper, you'll put something within a plan, you don't sometimes really appreciate how will that work in real life. So actually doing role playing. Remember I showed you those images from Sydney Festival and they had the girl on the ground with the 2.1 meter pod marked out. So they actually practiced it in office buildings. You know, they marked it out, a few of the pods, and just seeing what it would be like. So make sure you do some role playing and test out some of your theories. Talk direct to the public health unit if necessary. If you've got any queries, communication is really important. And submit your COVIDSafe plan early so that you can get all the questions back from them and work on solutions specific to your event. What's happened with a lot of events that have put forward COVIDSafe plans in other states, they haven't necessarily got through straight away. So the Public Health Department of Health have come back with some questions or some clarification and have also offered some other solutions for the event. So once again, like I said earlier in our session, it's really important for you to go through this process as early as possible to make sure that you allow the time to get your event organised. They also suggested meet Department of Health on site if you can. Like I said before, these guys are not event planners. And we need to remember that. So if we can ask them on site and we can ask them questions and be open to their suggestions, that's really useful. But we also want to be very confident and strong in how we are going to do things. Another great tip was don't overthink it. And I thought that was probably one of my favorites. Don't overthink it. And this particular person said, you know, for them, it was almost going back to kindergarten, you know, going back to basics where we had to like go, don't push in the queue and keep our distance in the tuck shop line. So it's that whole thing, just don't overthink this too much. Although there's lots of points to consider, don't overthink it. Make it fun. Remember the toilet cleaners' names? Love it. So where you can make it fun, especially for your volunteers. Everyone said we need to start the contact tracing process earlier. So as we talked about, pre-register via things like Eventbrite or Try Booking and use QR codes on site. So even if it's a free event, really look into that idea of pre-registering or pre-purchasing tickets. Make sure that volunteers are easily identified with high-vis vests. And another good one was if you have more space available to you, use it. Spread out as much as you can. If you need to chat to council about getting some extra space on your site, do so, because the tip is the more space you have, the better. And the final one was, and everybody said this, and this is something I've talked about in earlier masterclasses, is don't be restricted by the way you've done things in the past. And that can be a challenge, you know, because we have a set way of how we've done things in the past. But we need to think differently. You know, as you can see, there's a lot of different things that need to be considered to ensure we're COVID safe. We're almost tipping events on their head. We're taking something that encourages people to be rubbing side by side and hugging each other and having a great time and, you know, socializing and congregating, and we're taking things that traditionally encourage that and now turning them right on their head to say we now need to discourage that but still deliver the same experience. So we need to think a bit different. And don't be scared to take advice. Now, as I've said multiple times, there are wonderful resources available on the Victorian State Government website. There's templates, there's guidelines, there's oodles of information available to events. And that is likely to change regularly. So staying up to date is really important. But jumping in and being clear on what information and resources are available to you is important. Even like I said before, there's downloadable signage and digital tiles, and you know, there's so much there to support events to be COVID safe. Make sure that you're tapping into those resources. Also, don't forget your local council. So Nicole is a great resource. So if you have specific questions about your event, or you want to bounce something around with somebody when you're looking at your COVID safe plan or checklist, then don't be scared to tap on, you know, Nicole's shoulder or talk to another event in your region and see how they've done it or how they're doing it. So with all that said, who's ready for 2021? Because we are talking about 2021 as the year pre-vaccine. It's almost a transition year. We've had a year in hiatus as an industry. 2021's really going to test us. So it's really important that as an event, with all of that said, it's really important that you consider your position and the ability for you to deliver on the required or desired attendee experience in a COVID-safe way. Can you actually do that? Is there any risk of you impacting your brand or your reputation by delivering a COVID-safe event that's going to be quite different from what your event looks like, has looked like in the past? And the reason I'm telling you this is there are some events that are deciding that they will be better off to wait another 12 months and hopefully in 2022 there may be a vaccine and they will be able to deliver an event that is a little closer to normal. But remember, there's no guarantee that restrictions will be removed in 2022. We're all still kind of crystal ball gazing. We're not sure what things will be like post a vaccine. And we're not really sure what the new normal will be for festivals. So we just need to think it through are we prepared and do we have the resources and support to deliver a COVID safe event in 2021? And I just want to share this video from the Parks Elvis Festival. Bear with me, it's about 4 minutes, but it's a really good example of how an event has, first of all, how they've gone through the process of making a decision on the future of their event, but probably more importantly, how they've communicated their decision. I work quite closely with the Parks Elvis Festival, and I know that this decision was not taken lightly. They've did a lot of scenario planning. They looked really closely at their event, but I'll let them share their story around their decision.
Hello, Elvis Festival fans and friends. Ken Keith, the Mayor of Parkshire here, and with Kathy Treasure, the Festival Director. It's with a very heavy heart that today we announce the Parks Elvis Festival will not be proceeding in 2021.
We've spent several months contingency planning, monitoring health advice, government restrictions and border closures. The health and safety of all our stakeholders, including our local community, fans, artists, volunteers, contractors and staff, has always been at the top of the list. And with the current situation, we cannot proceed safely with confidence for 2021.
The Parks Elvis Festival is all about thousands of fans of people coming to celebrate the King, sing along to his hits, dance and socialise throughout the friendliest town in Australia, Parks.
Social distancing and limiting numbers would be very hard to adhere to, and we want everyone to experience the true spirit of the festival.
So sadly, we join with many other great festival and events this year in this announcement. My message for everyone listening, in the true spirit of Elvis Presley, be kind, walk a mile in the shoes of all that this will impact, and let's stick together through these tough times. We will certainly miss all our fans descending on Parks and sending our love out there to all of those people throughout Australia and overseas.
However, as Elvis also once said, when things go wrong, don't go with them. This break will allow for a time of planning and launching an incredible 2022.
So lock in the 5th to the 9th of January 2022 for the biggest and best Elvis Festival in the 29-year history. But enough from us. Let's hear from some of the many, many people who make this festival what it is today. And it looks like no more hair for another 12 months, Kathy. What a shame.
Hey Elvis fans, greetings from Graceland. We just wanted to say thank you so much to the Parks Elvis Festival for helping us keep Elvis's memory alive. We look forward to seeing everyone back at the festival in 2022.
Hello Parks, this is Taylor Rodriguez. Hold on 1 second. Hello Parks, this is Taylor Rodriguez. We were so looking forward to seeing you all, but unfortunately we can't be there in 2021. But don't worry, we're sending you a big hunk of love and we'll be there in 2022. Hope to see you all soon. God bless and take care.
Well, we've had 28 festivals and looks like we're gonna have to take the year off for the next one.
Well, you'll just have to get back to the garden, Bob.
Don't worry, I'm brewing up a big hunk of love to welcome you back.
Ashton, take a break. You've got a whole year to practice.
Time's up, the King.
G'day, it's Adam Harvey here. Now, I'm really disappointed that the Elvis Festival in Parks has had to be cancelled, so I know we're all going to really miss that festival in 2021. But the good news is, 2022, the Elvis Festival in Parks is going to be bigger and better than ever, so we'll see you there.
Hi, everybody, it's Jack Gatto here. Just like to wish all of the disappointed fans a big hunker burning love. Hope you're staying safe, staying well, and I look forward to seeing you at the next Parks Elvis Festival.
Hi everyone, my name is Damien Mullen from Melbourne, and I promise you I have not left the building. I'm looking forward to performing at the Parks Elvis Festival in 2022, and I can't wait to see you all there. So when the time comes, let's rock and roll.
Just heard, the Elvis Festival's not going ahead.
Does that mean I get to be Miss Priscilla for another year?
Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Stewie V from Perth, Western Australia, and I'm missing the fans, I'm missing the stage, and I'm missing everybody. So I've got a burning love to see y'all in Parks in 2022. Thank you very much.
Houston, we have a problem. The Parks Elvis Festival is off for 2021.
My suit's going to be more popular than your suit next year.
We miss you. Can't wait to take a running low into the 2022 Parks Elvis Festival.
Until we can meet again, I'm sending all my love to all the wonderful supporters of the Parks Elvis Festival. I hope to see you all in 2022.
Thank you very much. Well, it's going to be lonesome in Parks in January.
We're going to miss you so much.
I'll see you in 2022.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So, that's... I'm not sure... if any of you know of Parks in regional New South Wales, a very significant regional festival that is held in January each year. I love watching that clip. For me, the way they have actually communicated that is just so impressive. You know, the integration with the community, with their stallholders and stakeholders and sponsors is just phenomenal. But the reason I wanted to share that is because it's an important consideration for all events because it is a lot of work to deliver an event. And although we don't know even what 2022 will look like, and there's still no guarantee of timing around vaccines, it's something you need to consider. You know, you need to weigh up the pros and cons. You need to do the scenario planning like we talked about in our last masterclass. I would love to see events happening in 2021. That's, you know, something I'm extremely passionate about. But for each of you, I really appreciate the amount of energy and time that goes in, and you want to make sure that you can deliver on the experience that's expected and the experience that you want to deliver on. And as you can hear from the message from Parks Elvis Festival, they just could not see how they could deliver a COVID-safe version of that event without impacting on the experience. So for them, as you just heard, they're investing another 12 months into planning and preparing for 2022 to come back with a big bang. So something that certainly needs to be considered when we're talking about COVID-safe planning. And just something that actually just hit my inbox this afternoon. Another event in Outback Queensland has made the same decision. So the Tara Kemmel Races, an event that is in a tiny little community, but this event has had great government support over the last few months and has really created this fantastic event for Outback Queensland. They have decided to wait out the COVID hump. So once again, a fantastic piece of communication to put that message out to their audience. So as you can see there, you know, the festival was such a success, and we know the format of what we are offering is so well loved. So once again, they could not see, or they decided that, you know, they just couldn't imagine their event with reduced attendance and having less people and allowing for social distancing. So it's a consideration that you need to throw into the mix for your event. And when you're looking at your COVID safe planning, please just consider the event experience and the brand reputation of your event as well, because that's